Well, if you'll open your Bibles to Matthew's Gospel, the 24th chapter, and verse 14 will be the basis for our message today, but I hope you'll keep your Bibles open because there are different verses that I want to show you that relate to this teaching we're studying today. Now, for those of you who are visiting for the first time in this month of December, I started last week and the last Sunday of November, what we're just talking about the Gospel, and today it's the Gospel of the Kingdom. Now, when people think of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's what Christmas is all about, the coming of Christ and what His life means to us, I doubt very many people think about a kingdom. They'll think about the Bethlehem scene, the manger. They'll think about the wise men, the shepherds, King Herod, all of that. Very few think about the kingdom, but the gospel is all about a kingdom. Jesus makes this statement. If you look in Matthew chapter 24, the disciples had asked Jesus some questions. He had just informed them as they were showing him the temple area. He said, all of this is going to come down. Not one stone will be left upon another. And they asked him these questions. It's right here in the first part of it. If you look in verse 3, as Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately and they said, tell us, when will this happen? When's all this temple area? When's it going to come down? What will be the sign of your coming, and what's going to be the sign of the end of the age? Well, Christ deals with those questions, but in verse 14 is what I want you to see. Look at the statement He makes. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end shall come. But He says the gospel of the kingdom. So let's think about this kingdom today that Christ speaks of, this gospel kingdom. First of all, is this kingdom only referred to in the New Testament? Well, no, it is not. There are plenty of references in the Old Testament. Now, look over in Isaiah chapter 9. Here's a familiar verse that comes to us in the season of Christmas. Isaiah the 9th chapter in verses 6 and 7. This prophecy is made hundreds of years before Christ came. It says, for us, to us the child is born, and to us the son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. Now, he uses a series of terms there to describe this one who's going to come. And he says, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Very descriptive words, and Christ fulfilled all of those teachings. But notice it also talks about the government will be upon his shoulders. And then in verse 7, it says, of the increase of his government and his peace, there will be no end. He will reign on the throne of David and over his kingdom. And so he's talking about the kingdom of God there. There's another passage in Isaiah. You can look up later on, Isaiah chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. I want you to look to Zechariah right now. That other passage in Isaiah talks about that kingdom. But Zechariah, here's an interesting statement. Zechariah is towards the end of the Old Testament. In chapter 9, in verses 9 and 10, Zechariah didn't completely understand this, but in these two verses, he talks about the first coming of Christ, and he talks about the second. Look what it says in verse 9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. And Zechariah is not going to understand that there is the royal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem before his crucifixion. But he's just writing these words as God inspires, and yet that's pointing to when Christ came the first time. But now look in the very next verse, in verse 10. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim, and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. And he's not talking about his first coming there, because that wasn't fulfilled in the first coming of Christ. That's talking about when Christ returns, and it's talking about his rule upon the earth and about his kingdom. And then in Daniel chapter 2, you don't have to turn to this, but in Daniel chapter 2, Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, has a dream. And he makes the unusual request of all the magicians. He said, you've not only got to interpret this dream for me, you've got to tell me what the dream is. Well, they were bumfuzzled. They thought, we can't do that. No one can do that. But Daniel got word to him and said, this can be done. And he and his friends prayed that God would give Daniel insight. And the Lord did do that. And so Daniel tells him the dream. And the dream's about this statue. And Daniel informs Nebuchadnezzar, now you're the head of gold. There's going to be another kingdom that follows you. There's going to be another kingdom that follows that one. There will be another kingdom that follows that one. But then he said, in your dream, you saw there was a little stone made without hands. It's not of the human origin. And it starts out just very small, but then it takes over all those kingdoms and it encompasses the whole earth. Well, then he gives the interpretation to this dream. And he says, that little stone is the kingdom of God. And it's going to come in the days of that latter kingdom, which was the Roman Empire, and Christ came in that time. And he said, this kingdom's going to encompass the whole earth. And so in the Old Testament, definitely this kingdom is referred to. And then when you think about the New Testament, look at these passages. I've already mentioned Matthew chapter 24 to you, but look what it says in Matthew chapter 3. John the Baptist, the forerunner of the Lord Jesus, he comes and look at the message he's delivering. It says, in those days, in verse 1 of chapter 3, John the Baptist came preaching in the desert of Judea, saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, voice of one calling in the desert, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. But he said, you need to repent, for the kingdom of God is near. Now look what it says in Matthew chapter 4, in verse 17. The Lord Jesus, the Bible says this, from this time on, Jesus began to preach, and here's what he preached. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. He said, this kingdom is here. In Matthew chapter 12, there were people who were accusing Jesus of doing his works by the power of Satan. And Jesus pointed out the fallacy of their thinking. But in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 28, Christ makes this statement. In fact, in verse 27, he said, if I drive out demons by Beelzebub, who is the devil, by whom do your people drive them out? So then they will be your judges. But he said, if I drive out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. And then look what it says in Colossians. Colossians in the New Testament in chapter 1, verses 12 and 13. The Apostle Paul writes these words. It says in verse 11, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and joyfully giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the kingdom of light. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And he's saying, now this kingdom is here, and here's a miraculous work. God has delivered believers from the domain of darkness, and they're now a part of this kingdom of God, right now. And then I want you to look at two other passages, one in Revelation. If you hear the Messiah during the Christmas season, then you will hear this verse explained and exalted in this song. But it says this in Revelation chapter 11 and verse 15, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and forever. But the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and Christ. Now, lest you think, well, really, at Christmas time, this doesn't have that much to do with Christmas. Well, sure it does. When the angel came and spoke to Mary and told this girl this young girl that maybe was about 17 years of age told her, you're going to have a child. And she couldn't believe that because she said, I've never been with a man. How can that possibly be? And the angel explained, well, this is a miraculous thing. This is the work of God. The Spirit of God is going to come upon you. But in Luke chapter 1, in verse 30, the angel makes a very interesting comment to Mary. It says in the 29th passage, Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, now don't be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you're to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end. So I mean, in the Christmas story, in this event, the angel said, Mary, this child that you're going to have will reign, and his kingdom is never going to end. So whether it's in the Old Testament or New Testament, this kingdom is definitely referred to. Well, I want us to talk just briefly about the three dimensions of this kingdom of God. First of all, and by the way, whether you say kingdom of God or kingdom of heaven, they're one and the same. And the first dimension, which we're living in right now, it is invisible. It arrived with the coming of Jesus Christ to this earth when he began his public ministry. And that's those verses that John the Baptist expressed in Matthew 3. And Jesus said the same thing, repent, believe, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The passage in Colossians where Paul says, you've been transferred from a domain of darkness into the kingdom of God. Now that kingdom at the present time, it's existed in the world. It has been since the time of Christ, but it is invisible. King Jesus is not reigning visibly in this earth. When they talk about political leaders or governmental leaders, they can show all these different leaders in their pictures and them walking across grass or them making some speech. King Jesus is not going to be in any of those pictures. It's not visible at the present time. He reigns in the lives of people who have received him as Savior. So the kingdom in that respect is invisible. And yet, again, I'd stress what a special rescue operation this was on the part of Christ. Here we were in a domain of darkness, and you may never even think of yourself like that. And yet the Bible says all people without Christ, that's where they reside. And they can be enslaved to sin, and they may be pretty good people, but still there's sin problems. And they're in this darkness, but when a person comes to understand their need of Christ and they accept him, then they go from that darkness and they become a part of the kingdom of God. And they're in this relationship with the Lord Jesus, and it's wonderful. But now there's the second dimension. It's the reign of Christ on the earth, visibly. Now look to Revelation chapter 20. Revelation, the 20th chapter. In verses 4 through 6. It says, I saw thrones on which were seated those who had been given authority to judge. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded. Well, that's a relevant word in this world in which we live today. Because of their testimony for Jesus. And because of the word of God. They had not worshipped the beast. That's the Antichrist, the one world ruler that the Bible speaks of at the end of time. They had not worshipped him or his image. And had not received his mark on their foreheads or their hands. They came to life and they reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until 1,000 years were ended. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy are those who have a part in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them. But they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. Let's talk about the reign of Christ on the earth. Now remember Jesus, when he gave what we know as the Lord's Prayer, he said, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Now I just ask you this question, would Jesus ever tell us to pray a prayer that has no chance of being fulfilled? You know, there's some people that say Jesus Christ will never reign on the earth. Well, that's not what these verses say. And when Jesus made this statement in the Lord's Prayer, "Thy kingdom come to the earth, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Well, that's not during this invisible reign. That's going to take place when Jesus comes back to the earth. But now the question is, when you read Revelation chapter 20, who will reign with Christ? Who's going to reign with him? And there are differences of opinion. You can read in verse 4 where it specifies and it says this, "I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony for Jesus and because of the word of God. They had not worshipped the beast or his image. And they came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. Now, some people say it's just going to be those who died during a tribulation time that will reign with Christ on the earth. And if you read just that passage, you can think, well, okay, that's correct. That's correct. It's just them. I've had a person say to me one time, they said, well, I think those who are going to reign with Christ on the earth are just New Testament believers. I don't think Old Testament believers will be in this reign. And I don't know how they base that, but I mean, some people have that kind of opinion. But here's what you need to understand. It says here in verse 5 and 6 that there are two resurrections. The first resurrection and the second resurrection. And here's the problem if you agree with either one of these things that I've just mentioned. That it's just those who lose their lives during the tribulation. They're the only ones who reign with Christ. Or if you think, well, just New Testament believers reign with Christ. Here's the issue. Two resurrections. If you accept either one of those other views I just mentioned, you've got to come up with three resurrections. There's a resurrection of these people that were martyred during the tribulation. There's one. If other believers are not raised and reign with Christ at that time, they've got to be raised after that. There's two. And then there's the resurrection of the lost. There's three resurrections. And you've got an issue there because the Bible specifies that there is just two. Now, some could say this. They could say, well, I think lumped into that first resurrection will not only be these. I think when other believers are raised, even though it's at a latter time, they're still included in the first resurrection. Well, the Bible doesn't say that. It doesn't say that at all. And the Bible also stresses this. It's only those who are in the first resurrection that the second death, meaning eternal torment, eternal hell, has no power over. Jesus, in John chapter 5, he taught there are two resurrections. He said there's going to be a resurrection of those who are believers and of those who are not. In fact, hold your place here in Revelation. Look over to John 5 real quick. John, the 5th chapter, because people wonder about this sometimes. How is all this going to unfold? John, in the 5th chapter, in verse 24, Jesus Christ says this, "I tell you the truth. Whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. I tell you the truth, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God and those who hear will live." Now look, he's not talking about a bodily resurrection there. He's saying the time has now come, right now, when those who hear and believe, he says that they will, these dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. He's just saying life spiritually is going to be imparted to them. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to judge because he is the Son of Man. Do not be amazed at this. Now look here in verse 28. A time is coming. Now notice he doesn't say, and now is. He said a time is going to come when all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good will rise to live, and those who have done evil will rise to be condemned. And you read that verse, you think, well, this happens all at the same time, but the passage is in Revelation. Jesus is just underscoring there are two resurrections. And the passage in Revelation clears it up for us. One is going to be before the reign of Christ on the earth. The other is going to be afterwards. But those involved in this second resurrection, they do not have any victory over death, eternal death. It's only those involved in the first resurrection. And the Bible would indicate to us very clearly that all believers are participants of this. Whether they're a New Testament believer, an Old Testament believer, whether they lived during the time of the tribulation and were martyred. And if you look in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, this clears it up. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 22 and 23. It says, for as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive, but each in his own turn. Christ the firstfruits. He's the one that conquered death on Easter. But then when he comes, when Jesus comes, it says, then those who belong to him. Then the end will come when he hands over the kingdom. But he says, when he comes, then believers, they're going to experience this resurrection. And it's after the reign of Christ on the earth that the lost are raised. Now, I'm going to interject here that in our society today, especially down here, this isn't everywhere, by the way, the teaching about a rapture of the church before the tribulation, or some believe in a rapture of the church midway through the tribulation, and that's really popular. And people who've been here for a long time know I don't believe that. I don't think there's going to be a rapture. I can't find verses in the Bible that teach that. And then if you believe that, here's an issue. Again, you've got to have three resurrections. Because if you believe in a rapture either before or midway through this tribulation, then there's one resurrection. Then what about people who accept Christ during the tribulation? Then there's got to be a second resurrection for them. And then after the reign of Christ, the lost will be raised. That'd be a third resurrection. And the Bible specifies there's only two. And it's going to take place when Jesus Christ comes back to this earth, as it says here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It's very clear on that, but that's so hopeful for believers. If you know Christ is Savior, death is not going to overwhelm your life. There will be some people who do not die. Most of us will, unless Christ comes back prior to that. But death does not have a hold on the believer's life. And believers are going to participate in this great resurrection when Christ comes back. Sometimes people want to disassociate Christmas and Easter. Well, no, they all go together. And it's great news. It's tremendous hope. A man in our church lost his father, and the funeral's tomorrow, but his father was a believer. Others have lost loved ones that are believers here recently. And we have hope, eternal hope, because of Christ and what he's done and what he accomplished in his first coming. But all believers will share in that resurrection. But now there's one final kingdom. After this reign of Christ, all believers reign with Christ on the earth. in the passages in Isaiah that talked about the kingdom of God, it's talking about this kingdom where Jesus reigns. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. Well, that's not taking place now. We don't have peace in the world now. And we can stand and we want to sing songs about peace, and that's good, that's wonderful. But listen, the passage in Luke, when the angels spoke to the shepherds, did not promise peace to all people. It says, unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And it says, peace will be upon those whom the Lord favors. And those whom he favors are those who trusted in him. He loves all people. He loves the people of ISIS. But his favor is not going to be upon their lives and the way that they live their lives and conduct themselves in such a brutal fashion. But it doesn't have to be that. It can be somebody just like you, that you'd never end another person's life. But you don't have Christ as your Savior. Don't think, well, God's peace is promised to me. No, it is not. It's upon those whom his favor rests. But when King Jesus comes back and he's reigning, then that's a different story. There will be peace in the earth. This passage in Isaiah, you don't have to turn to it, but just listen to it real quick. Isaiah, in the second chapter, gives this beautiful announcement. It's in verses 3 and 4, and it says this. Many peoples will come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways so that we may walk in his paths. The law will go out from Zion and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. When Christ comes and establishes his kingdom, then there's going to be justice and righteousness, and then there's going to be peace. And that kingdom will be for a period of time, the fulfilled period of time that God designates. But now there's one other kingdom that's referred to, or it's just a different part of this one, and it's the eternal kingdom of God. The eternal. You know, the Bible talks about that even in the book of Isaiah. Isaiah in chapter 65, in verses 17 through 19, it says this, behold, I will create a new heavens and a new earth. The former things will not be remembered, nor will they come to mind. A new heaven and new earth. Some of you know the Bible enough to realize, well, in the New Testament it talks about that. Did you know this verse was in the Old Testament? And that God gave this message, there's going to come a day when there will be a new heavens and a new earth. And then in the New Testament, you find this teaching. Look what it says in 2 Peter chapter 3. If you're in Revelation, you're real close to 2 Peter. 2 Peter, the third chapter. In verses 10 through 13, it says this. The day of the Lord will come like a thief. People will not expect it. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you look forward in the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth, the home of righteousness. And he uses the exact same terminology that Isaiah the prophet did hundreds of years before. And then in Revelation, after it talks about the reign of Christ on the earth, it talks about how the lost will be brought forth and there's going to be a great white throne judgment. And all people who do not know Christ will be at this judgment. I stated last week, you cannot escape God. No matter what, you cannot escape him. And if you haven't accepted Christ, you will be at this judgment. It says, look at this, in Revelation chapter 20, verse 11, then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it. Earth and sky fled from his presence and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, the small and the great. Oh, you can be great in the eyes of the world, have plenty of power, plenty of money, But if you don't have Christ, you'll be standing at this judgment. Standing before the throne, and books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. Jesus said, every man will give account of his life. Every idle word that men shall speak, he'll give account of. Then look at this. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades. When he says the sea and death, he's talking about where bodies are buried. People are buried at sea, or death meaning the grave. So he's talking about the body being released. But then look, it also says this, Hades gave up the dead which were, that were in them. Hades is the place where a lost person's spirit goes when they die. They don't go to an eternal hell right then. This is not purgatory. There's no such thing as purgatory. This is a holding cell, but it is a place of torment, and they're there until this judgment. And the Bible says, the sea gave up the dead that were in it. Death and Hades gave up the dead. The body and the spirit of the lost person will be resurrected and united together. And then it says, they were judged according to what they had done. And death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. Remember, only those who participate in the first resurrection, the second death has no power over them. But for all those who are not in that first resurrection, it does have power. It says, if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, they were thrown into this lake of fire, and they'll be there forever. There's no escaping of that. So all that takes place, but then look what it says in Revelation 21. It comes back to this final dimension of the kingdom of God. It says there's a new heaven. I saw this new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. But he said, I saw all of this. And I want to tell you, that kingdom, the eternal kingdom of God, the beauty will be indescribable. There's no way you can describe that. You can see your prettiest scene in the world today. It doesn't even compare. I think of that shot of the earth when the astronauts were in space and they focused back on the earth and all the beautiful, brilliant colors and how marvelous it looked. Nothing. That won't even compare what this is like. There will be complete fulfillment in serving Christ. You know, people wonder, eternity, my word, eternity, what will we do? Surely we'll get bored, because we can get bored down here. No one will get bored in heaven. There is complete fulfillment. No one's going to be dissatisfied. No one's going to feel overwhelmed with the pressures of life. No, not at all. Complete fulfillment. There will be no trace of evil or sin. Aren't you glad about that? I drove home the other night. Our staff had their little Christmas get-together on Friday evening. When I went home, I'm going down Midwest Boulevard to get over to 15th Street, and there's three police cars with several police officers and a house right there on Midwest Boulevard. And I asked the police officer who's on duty here today, what was going on? Well, there was a shooting. People got shot. One's critical. And you hear this, the killings over in the Middle East and all the things that take place and the abuse that occurs constantly here in this country and around the world. Aren't you glad there's going to be a day when there will be no sin, no murder, no abuse, no adulteries, no liars, none of that. Be perfect peace in this kingdom forever. There will be wonderful unity. No one's going to be in disagreement with anyone else. There won't be any stress, no problems, no discouragement. A lot of people get discouraged. A lot of people struggle with depression. I just received a Christian magazine. It's called Facts and Trends, and it talked in there about the issue of depression. It was talking about how ministers have the problem within their lives, and people have this problem. And if you do, I mean, it's nothing to be ashamed of. About not at all. A lot of people suffer from that and struggle with that. And thankfully, the Lord can help us in that, and we can get help. But I mean, that's an issue. You won't have to deal with that in eternity. None of that. It's just beyond anything we can imagine. That's why Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9, it says this, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, neither has entered the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those who love him. This kingdom, this eternal kingdom. But it's for believers. Now, the final thought is just this, the key question, will I be a part of this kingdom? Well, you know, Jesus makes this abundantly clear to us in John chapter 3. And I want you to look at this, and then we'll be through. John, the third chapter. Because people wonder, how do I get to be a part of His invisible kingdom in this earth? And I want to reign with Christ on the earth, and I want to be a part of the eternal kingdom. How can I be a part of all this? Well, Jesus explains it. And a man named Nicodemus came to see Jesus one night. And I'm so glad this was Nicodemus. I'm just thrilled this wasn't some murderer that came to Jesus. I'm grateful it wasn't somebody that was like Solomon that had all these different women or some woman that had all these different men. I'm grateful it wasn't a drunkard that came to Jesus. Somebody on drugs having problems that's just wreaked havoc in the lives of people. I'm thankful it wasn't somebody like that. Now, I want to tell you this. Any of those people, well, Jesus will forgive them in a heartbeat and accept them and change their life if they'll let Him. But in this instance, I'm really glad it wasn't somebody like that. Instead, this is Nicodemus. This is not a man who's some bad man. This is a good man. He's a real good man. He is a religious leader. He was so well thought of. He was looked up to. All the citizens that knew him would have thought for sure, Nicodemus, this man, is going to go to heaven. And you know people like this. People so good. In fact, some of you may think of yourself like this. That I'm really a good person. Not trying to brag. You could just say, I'm just a good person. And I work hard at being good. And if God's going to take other people into heaven, then He certainly is going to take me. Well, here comes this man Nicodemus. It's so wonderful. And he comes and he pays Jesus a compliment. He was a thoughtful man. He said, well, now, Jesus, we know that no one could do the things that you do unless God be with him. And look what it says. Look how Jesus responded to him. Jesus didn't thank him for the compliment. He just said this. Verse 3. John chapter 3, verse 3. He said, Nicodemus, I tell you the truth. No one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. Nicodemus, you good man, you'll never see the kingdom of God unless you're born again. And Nicodemus said, well, how can this happen? Is a person to enter their mother's womb a second time? He was just totally confused. And Jesus explained, I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and of spirit. Water meaning a physical birth, spirit, a spiritual birth. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. But he says, Nicodemus, you've got to be born again. And that only happens when a person receives Christ into their life. Prior to this, the Bible says we are dead in our trespasses and our sins. We have no life of God within us. Jesus said, the only way that you can be a part of my kingdom is you've got to be born again. And I know society, the movies, people in politics, they use this term born again, and they certainly don't use it in the way Jesus does. I remember that show Rocky where Apollo Creed is going to fight this Russian. He winds up getting killed in the ring. But he says to Rocky before this started and all the people are cheering, he said, I just feel born again. That's not what Jesus is talking about. Jesus is talking about you receiving him as your Savior. And then he comes into your life and into your spirit and imparts the life of God. Then and only then are you born again. And Jesus, you look at his words. Jesus said, no matter how religious you are, you could be Baptist, Catholic, Methodist, whatever you want to be, Hindu, Buddhist. Jesus said, no one will enter my kingdom unless they're born again, unless they receive me. But the Bible says those who receive him, John chapter 1, verse 12, to as many as receive him, to them gives he the right to become the children of God, even to those who believe on his name. Listen, have you been born again? Are you a part of God's kingdom? Well, you can be. If you've never trusted in Christ, you can be. This can happen for you today. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord Jesus, I thank you. Your kingdom's in the earth now invisibly, and thank you that you reign in the lives of believers. But Lord, we look forward to that day. You're coming back to this earth, and for all who trust in you will reign with you. But then, Lord Jesus, that will even transition into the eternal kingdom, the new heavens and the new earth. And yet, Lord, you've made it so clear that unless someone's born again, it doesn't matter how good they are, how well people think of them. The fact is, we all have a sin problem, a sin issue that separated us from you. And the only way we can ever be a part of your kingdom is to know you. And Father, I know many in this room have received you, and I'm grateful and give you praise for that. But there could be people sitting right here that have never made that commitment. And maybe they're counting on the fact, well, I'm a good Baptist or whatever else, and that's going to get me taken care of. And Lord, help them to know they won't. It will not. Jesus, you made it so clear, no one will enter the kingdom unless they've met you, unless they're born again. So for people who need you and need to trust in you, I pray that you draw them to yourself. And Lord Jesus, I ask this in your name. And while our heads are still bowed and our eyes are closed, we're going to be dismissed in a moment. But after we're dismissed, I'll be right here at the front. And if you'd like to receive Christ into your life, then I encourage you. I really urge you. If you've never trusted in Christ, you can do that today. I hope you'd make your way down here to the front, and we'll tell you and share with you how you can be a part of knowing Christ and have a relationship with Him. And if there's any other commitment, maybe you're a believer and you're wanting to place your life here at Meadowood and be a part of this church, we'd invite you to come forward too. And we'll share with you how you can be a part here. Lord, bless you. Thank you so much for being here today and listening so patiently. And I pray He blesses you. Pray you're having a good Christmas season. And I look forward to seeing you tonight.